in me and giving me this opportunity. It means a lot for me. Thanks, Dr. Pradeep, an evergreen friend, I think a live wire, wherever he is. And thank Vanita for that wonderful introduction.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Can somebody share the screen now so that I can see my first slide?
Yes, I'll do that. Just give me a minute.
Yeah. Yeah, while I talk about, you know, plants having animal instincts, etc., but then there's a little difficulty in explaining animal instinct and the behavior when we talk about things like animals or plants, especially plants, because they don't have consciousness, not yet found. They don't have kind of a memory or awareness what humans have. So it's a little difficult. It's very difficult for human mind to understand that it's a gene or a gene which actually, can you change the next slide, please? Actually gives a lot of data. Like in humans, this is an RNA. This is exactly what COVID RNA would look like in 35 base pairs. You know, in humans, we have intelligence, we have brain, we have an advanced system, then we have instincts. We have paleo brain, which is basically from, you know, animal time that we have acquired, which has certain capacities, but then such capacities cannot be seen with animals or plants. But then the actual wonder of living happens at the cellular level. Each cell has an robust ability to sustain itself, you know, creating and utilizing energy, you know, multiplying, sustaining itself and contributing. So when it comes to, you know, reality of life, we think there is a, you know, one proposal that it's actually selfishness of the gene or selfishness of the RNA or selfishness of the DNA, which works. If you look at the Earth, the energy, whole of energy on Earth is basically from sun. Because from the sun, it is taken by plants, and plants are eaten by marine or, you know, land animals. These are herbivores, and herbivores are eaten by, you know, carnivores. And if you look at every time, if somebody has food, there is violence. When I say violence, visible violence or invisible violence. Invisible violence is when you eat vegetarian food. But then whenever, whatever happens, there's only one fellow who really gets benefited, that is the gene. It is, if you look at the whole world, there's only one purpose which is constantly happening, which is, you know, duplication of gene. Now let's think about animate and not, living and non-living being. There are three principal differences among living and non-living beings. Living beings have the ability, they have a certain longevity, which is precise, and it is a range. Within this longevity, they have the ability to reproduce themselves. When I say reproduce themselves, it's actually reproducing the cells which are identical DNA or identical RNA. So they have the ability to reproduce. The thirdly, most important is fecundability, which basically means that when they reproduce an identical being. A donkey gives birth to a donkey, a horse gives birth to a horse, and a human gives birth to a human. So reproducing self is the basic function. So while doing this, they have built enormous amount of systems which work inside, and those systems lead to the feelings, or those systems lead to a lot of activity. But it's very difficult for us to understand that the system leads to the activity, but it's very easy for us to say that human being or the animal or the plant does it. So like active voice is much easier than passive voice. I'll be telling that plants do this, or plants feel bad, or plants hear, which basically does not mean that they really hear. They have a, when I say plants can hear, it only means that plant has a system which can identify, sense the sound. That's all it means. But then for easiness of our understanding, I will say plants will be hearing, etc. But ultimately it is this. This RNA is so, so important that this, you know, there are, what you see there are, you know, the nucleosides, A, U, C, and G. And it's a single pair, just like a coronavirus. It's a sense or, you know, single pair, 35 base pair RNA, which is present. And this RNA, if you really look at philosophically, has got the corona RNA, has nothing to gain. it just enters the body, utilizes the body's cells, and creates its own replications or multiple copies, and sends it out. And give, and you know, because of secretions, it can pass on to the next person, and it creates its own copies. This is actually the philosophy. Nothing more than that. It doesn't have feeling. It cannot have friends. It doesn't have Rotary Club. It has nothing. All it has is a code, which is able to enter the cell, multiply, and infect somebody else. So this is all about life. And we are lucky to have, you know, doing three works. We are doing virucidal work. That is, we can kill the virus better than remdesivir. We are also able to identify the actual immune. If you look at 98% of people come out of COVID without any, you know, without death, and 87% are asymptomatic. If that is the case, that means we have inbuilt ability to fight this virus. So we are doing a study among doctors who are working in the COVID hospitals but not getting infected. Why they are not infected? What is that uniqueness in their, you know, immune system? That's the second work. And the third, we are proud to say that this is because of 75 applications, only one company got a grant yesterday. That's a 1 crore grant, basically for identifying, creating a platform. People talk about immunity. Now, nobody knows what is immunity means. Immunity booster. What does it mean by boosting immunity? Nobody really knows. So we are creating a platform to see whether the cells can stop the virus entering. Rather than, you know, fighting the virus cannot enter the cell and hence it goes off. So this is from the genetic angle that I'll be speaking in a active voice, which should be actually passive voice. Next slide, please. When I say animal instinct, next slide. Okay. Now, what do plants do? Do they, can they hear? Can they smell? Can they touch? Actually, though they cannot do that, I will explain two experiments. This is a plant. This plant can hear the noise of the wings from the bees. The moment it hears the noise of the bees, it starts creating more and more and starts secreting sugary juice. So more sugary juice basically means that bees get more attracted and, you know, they stay there longer, they pollinate. So this particular plant called Enothera rumendil, This particular plant can sense the vibration sound of the honeybees as well as some more insects. So this says that there is something in this plant which can sense the sound. There was a similar experiment carried out earlier. They, in a laboratory in US, Virginia University, they just kept some a row of grass in a containment, and there was a pipe of water which was running in one side. As they were experimenting, they used to run water through the pipes. That means pipe makes the water makes noise inside the pipe. They have designed it that way. And they suddenly realized that all the roots inside that particular contained area were going towards the, you know, the pipe. That basically means the root can hear the vibration of the, you know, water. But another interesting fact they observed is they recorded the voice of water. They kept it on that side and tried to see whether the roots gets attracted, and they realized roots don't get attracted. That basically means the subtle difference in the running water and the recorded sound of water could be identified by the plants. So they do respond to sound. Similarly, they respond to touch, you know about touch me not, and they respond to smell. Many plants, if you when the gardener goes and tries to cut the plants, they actually secrete a kind of we call this a phenolic compound, which is a volatile oil. The moment this oil gets supplied, it is in the air, the rest of the plant becomes bitter. So this is actually a response for insects. If an insect comes and starts munching on the leaves, the other rest of the plant realizes that there is an insect, so I have to protect myself. So it leaves the scent, and the scent is sensed by the same plant or the neighboring plant, and it will make the leaves bitter, and naturally the insect has to give up and go somewhere else. So plants do have this kind of ability. They have many other sense for light, they have sense for heat, etc. So it's just that we don't see it. Next slide, please. So when we talk about plants and animals, we only think that, next slide, please. when we talk about plants and animals, we just think that, you know, nature is nice, nature is good, you know, that is phenomenal. But I'll tell you about the four things what cuckoo does. This is called cuckoo. So this cuckoo looks like a hawk, and that's the first deception it does. It goes near the host bird. This is a warbler. This cuckoo goes near a host bird, and this, since the cuckoo looks like hawk, the warbler thinks that this is, you know, hawk, and it runs away. This is the first deception it does. Once the warbler runs away, it'll go and lay the eggs there on the, you know, in the same place. Sometimes it will remove one or two eggs and keep its egg, which is identical. Again, it is very deceptive. So now the warbler will keep on, you know, looking after these eggs, and the eggs will hatch. The chick will come out, and the picture on the right hand side, the longitudinal ones, is one of the most cruel things which you could ever see. See this here, this chick has hatched. The chick is of cuckoo. It's not of warbler. And that chick has got a designed shoulder in such a way that it will eject the eggs of the warbler out. See, when the warbler is feeding the cuckoo chick, what cuckoo chick is doing is throwing the eggs out of the mother, the same mother who is feeding her. It's a foster mother which is feeding. So that's kind of the cruelty they have. And it doesn't stop there. What cuckoos do is they will stand near the nest and they will cry. You know, there's something called food cry, you know, hunger cry. They will create noise like a hunger cry, as if the chick is doing the hunger cry. And this warbler will run and start feeding it again and again and again. So this is what cuckoo does. And a similar thing is done even by the plants, which I'm going to tell you later. But before that, a small trivia. If cuckoo is called Kannada, in Kannada, it is called Kogile. So those people who sing well sometimes are called Kannada the Kogile. So sometimes I feel, yeah, do you want to be really called as Kannada the Kogile? Do you know the other part of, you know, behavior of the cuckoo? So I don't want to be called. I keep telling, my wife says, I don't want to be called as cuckoo because Kogile, because, you know, I know about what, you know, cuckoo does. Next slide, please. So how do plants emulate same? Do they do similar? See, this is siblicide. This is pretty common. This is another kite which kills. Usually what happens, they have two or three eggs. The first one will hatch first, and that will be usually stronger than the second one. The first chick is stronger, and it has got the ability to, you know, fight with the younger chick, which is 2 or 3 days older than, younger than him. And it will go peck and kill that particular sibling. So this is this kind of siblicide, or killing the sibling, is quite often seen in the animal world as well as in the bird world. So do plants do it? Next slide, please. Next slide. Okay. This is a plant called Dalbergia sisu on the left-hand side. And this amazing work was done by somebody from our agriculture university, Bangalore, Ganeshaya and Uma Shankar. You know, they were the pioneers in identifying this work. And really, it's a phenomenal work they presented across the world. It was done as early as 1980s. And there are a couple of things which I'm telling here is from their work. And there is another madam by name Prarthana, who has also done work. Now, this on the left-hand side, what you see is Dalbergia sisu. It's a green leaf. And if you closely observe, there are 3 to 4 small seeds there. These are small germinating seeds in the plant. But if, as you see on the center, that same a plant, when it grows, we can call it a pod. It's actually, for us, it is a fruit. This fruit, when it grows, you can see that it grows as only as a single seed. So what happens to the rest of the seeds? The first seed can be called as the bigger brother or bigger sister, which kills the rest of the seeds. The first seed actually, that gets pollinated first. So it grows first. It grows probably 10 to 15 days or say 2 to 3 days prior to the other seed. So it matures fast. As it matures fast, it will secrete a thing called indolic acetic acid, AAA, IAAA, and that one will kill the rest of the seeds. This is something like, you know, a brother killing brother, or, you know, sister, sibling rivalry, exactly like the other one. So this phenomena is seen quite often. Sometimes what happens is it will not be one. On the right-hand side, what you see is myrtifolia. This particular plant, in this plant, you can see that alternatively, one seed is killed. So a seed is able to kill one, but not all. So even here, you can see the same sibling rivalry. And so how does the plant really solve this problem? You know, when I say solve, again, I'm talking in the active voice. So plant has, few ways by which it can solve it. The first one is avocado, for example, only one seed. When there are two people, they fight. So if you have only one person, there is no way that you can fight. So it creates one single seed and keeps. And always, if you look at one single seed, is a big seed, a healthy seed, and it's easy to multiply. But then it has got its own evolutionary disadvantages. The second one, if you closely look at it, it's an orange. If you look at the orange, there's two. You can see some seeds are big, some seeds are small. The smaller seeds are small because the big seed actually don't let the small seed grow. And so how do you solve the problem? So the orange has solved this problem by creating multiple layers. So at least not one, you will have five or six or at least 10 seeds which can germinate. So the layers in between what you see in a lemon and citrus fruits is basically to safeguard that particular seed from the neighboring big fellow. And I always say that I always appreciate groundnut because groundnut has got two seeds. And if you look at it, they don't fight. They are always of equal size. You can never see one does not kill the other. So they are such a friendly guy. So if you really look from the plant world, you should say, Sahodara idre shenga vijatara irbeku. They should be like groundnut. You know, they are so friendly. And hats off to them. Next slide, please. So is it just that, or do plants also are jealous about their own children? Yes. Your first plant, you would have quite often seen this. This is used for Ganesha, this flower. The second one is Calotropis gigantea. The first plant is also Calotropis gigantea. This is a weed which is usually seen in dry, arid areas. And it will be always alone. The reason it is alone is that it has got latex in it. That it will spread the latex across and it doesn't let any other plant grow nearby. So not only its own sibling, it will not let its own seed cannot germinate within when the latex is present there. So this is something like, parent-offspring conflict. And how does they solve it? You know, it has got a third way of keeping the child away from it, that it has got dehiscence happens wherein the seed gets dispersed through floating, it has got cotton there. So this cotton starts floating in the air and it goes away. So this is like sending your children to, hostel and you enjoying your life. Similarly, the calotropis does the same thing. So and there are quite a few plants, and including ficus. Ficus doesn't let, don't think that below ficus, nothing can grow. Actually, things can grow there. It is not because of just sunlight. If you look at, there are many other ficuses where sunlight is, many other trees where sunlight is much lesser, but ficus actually, fruits have got an acid which do not let anything else germinate there. So that's how even ficus lets its fruits away. Now, this is another type of ficus. Can you see, and below on the right-hand side, if you really look at, this is a parasitic plant. It also belongs to ficus family. You can see the figs here. This particular fellow will go, these fig seeds will go and they will be dropped by the birds on other plants, usually are big trees. Those trees are usually dilapidated and a little older trees, and slowly it will start germinating there. It will have its roots right into the tree. It is a parasite. It will take all its nutrition from that tree, and it engulfs the tree so much that ultimately it kills the tree. Just imagine you would have seen the movie Parasite. It's exactly like a movie Parasite. Probably it was inspired by this particular tree. But the good part about this tree is this tree gives so many fruits that below this tree, you can see bushes and plants and everything because of the birds. It is almost, it gives you fruits for around 5 to 6 months. And a lot of birds come there and they drop the seeds of other plants. And that's why there'll be a big colony of other people. So this is a strange phenomena. Now, the one which gives you shelter is killed where you nurture somebody else. So that's why I say it's really cruel. Now, lastly, you can see the coconut. Why is coconut designed the way it is? coconut is designed the way it is just to not make sure that even you know this coconut can be dispersed in the water. It can float. Mostly coconut is in the seashore and such areas because it likes salty water. So this coconut gets floats and goes somewhere else and it germinates. It is like we say that coconut is a good example of sending children to abroad for studies. Coconut probably came from Caribbean, and from Caribbean they send them to their children, small coconuts, to India, and it got settled in India. So this kind of behavior is there with the plants. Next slide, please. Okay, this is pretty interesting. Do plants have close, intricate love with any other animals? You'll be really surprised. Why I have shown the Karnataka here, Bidar, Gulbarga, Raichur, Ballar, you can see all the districts there, and Bangalore is in the deep pink. It's maroon color.
Right.
This is called banyan. You heard about banyan tree? It's Ashwathamara. Ashwathamara is also like a bit of fig. It is called Ficus religiosa, and this particular plant is a tree. Is this species is called keystone species. The reason for them to be called as a keystone is because they contribute a lot and lot for the ecology. You will be surprised if I tell you everything. It is so complicated. It's almost you may start forgetting what I'm telling. There is so much of relation between. Can you see a wasp there? Small wasp. This wasp and this particular tree. This particular tree can be pollinated only by this one wasp. That is of one species. And the best part is right now, I met some student in agriculture college again who is working on this. He says that the wasp strain, thing, which is present in Bangalore, cannot pollinate the one in Mysore. It cannot. The Mysore strain is different. Bangalore is different. Salem is different. Chennai is different. Or, each area has its own species, not species, strain, means a genetic variant of the same species. Now, what is so peculiar about this? You might have seen figs. Okay, if you are a vegetarian, eating fig is something like, I'm not too sure whether you should be eating figs, because figs are always infested with worms. You cannot get fig without worms. It's impossible. There'll be larvae, there'll be worms, etc. Fig, what you see as a fruit, is not a fruit. It's actually an inflorescence. Inflorescence is bunch of flowers. There are male flowers and female flowers right inside. Just think that sunflower has been, covered totally, and the flowers are inside. Even sunflower in the center, what you see is male, and around are female. So these have to be pollinated inside. So how do they pollinate? For pollinating, this particular wasp goes and makes a small hole. That gets into the hole. While it gets inside the hole, it loses its wings, so it gets completely paralyzed. It can only move there. It goes inside and lays eggs in the female ovary, why I say strain is different is this guy has a long tube through which it lays egg, and that long tube fits exactly for this particular tree. So the long tube of the wasp of Bangalore will not fit for the long tube of the ovule of Salem tree. And could be that is the reason every temple, every, burial grounds used to have this tree. The problem is this. This tree lives for 100 years. But this particular wasp lives only for a few days, 20 days or 30 days. So what does it mean? It basically means that this wasp, when it goes and lays eggs in the fig flower or fig fruit, whatever you can call it as, and when it hatches, when it comes out within 4 to 8 kilometers, because it can fly only that much, within 4 to 8 kilometers, there should be another fig which is flowering. Basically means every 20 days, there should be one fig within 3 or 4 kilometers which is flowering. It looks amazing, and you must think that does it really happen? It does happen. How does it help to ecology? Since there is a flowering fig within 4 to 8 kilometer area every day throughout the year, a fig is flowering in one area. So what is the advantage? So it becomes the basic diet for many, many birds. if you can see fig tree, you can see so many of the so many fruits, and you can also see a lot of birds coming there. And that's why it is called keystone, you know, species, which has life for, which gives life for a lot of ecology. So before you cut a fig tree, or before you cut a ashwatha or a religious, ficus religiosa tree, think twice. You may be actually destroying the ecology of the total system. Go back, please. There's one more interesting thing which happens there. Very interesting is this particular fellow will, this wasp will lay eggs and it will die because its wings are gone. After that, once the larvae comes, now these larvae will come as a male, you know, first. That male has, can bite and, you know, open up all the other, you know, ovaries, and the females come and male dies and the females fly away. So for a female to go out, the male makes the hole and gives, and it flies away. So if you really start looking, there are another 7 or 8 things which are lock and key between the wasp and this particular religious tree. Next slide, please. So that's the eternal love between these two trees. This is very interesting. It has been found that the honeybee species, which comes to, you know, on the left-hand side on the top, what you see is a coffee flower. And you would have seen it smells very good, actually. It smells almost like jasmine because a similar compound is there in that. These honeybees repeat and return to only coffee flowers. They don't go to others because they are addicted to caffeine. The caffeine addiction is so much that sometimes next year it will come to this, it will have a memory and come to the same plant again and again and again and again. So the addiction is not common for a human alone. On the right hand side, what you see is another huge story of a relationship between that the plant is nicotine, you know, tobacco plant. The what you see there is a caterpillar. On the left hand side, left, what you see is a moth. This moth and this nicotine tree are nicotine plant have got symbiosis. So this plant, this moth comes and lays eggs on the nicotine leaves, and they grow up to be larvae and you know, caterpillars. And this caterpillar munch on nicotine leaves. So caterpillar munch on nicotine leaves. That means there'll be so much of nicotine which is getting into you know, tobacco leaves. The nicotine getting into it. This small, this will be just about 1 centimeter long. This small 1 centimeter long caterpillar eats tobacco equivalent to 16 cigarettes a day. Even humans, 16 cigarettes a day will definitely become sick. So how does this caterpillar manage? It's very interesting. This caterpillar has an ability, is an enzyme, which can you know, bind to nicotine, and it will pass nicotine out every 5 to 10 minutes. So every time it munches, takes the nicotine in, it throws it out. But more interestingly, if you closely look at it, it has got small holes throughout its left and right flanks, small holes. Through the holes, it will, you know, puff out nicotine. So why? There are birds, there are some insects, there are some spiders who are very fond of this particular caterpillar. So when the spider comes, this fellow will puff out the caterpillar, will puff out the nicotine smell, and seeing the smell, this particular spider runs away. And I have a video, it's a little difficult on the PDF, so I have not shown, I can share it with you. And the most, there are 23 types of relationship between the caterpillar, a moth, and this tobacco. But I cannot tell all, but I'll tell you the most important part. The most efficient way of pollination of tobacco is through moth. But sometimes moth will lay more eggs, most of them will stay, and most of them will grow, and in the end, there'll be no leaves. If such a case happens, see, you can see on the left-hand side, there's a small flower, and you can see the flower is moving towards down, and moth is coming and trying to pollinate. I mean, it is trying to get the nectar. Meanwhile, it will pollinate. Now, if there are too many, you know, caterpillars munching on and destroying a lot of leaves, this particular nicotine tree, nicotine plant, will not will bloom another flower which is bigger in size. There's a moth, small moth flower blooms in the night because moth comes in the night. Whereas it, once it sees that this is dangerous for me to bring more moths, it will give a bloom a flower during daylight, and it is made for hummingbird. So hummingbird will come and pollinate. Now the question is, why can't it just pollinate the hummingbird? But hummingbird is not really an effective pollinator, because hummingbirds are less in number, and hummingbirds cannot carry the pollens as efficiently as the moth. So this is the kind of relationship which is present with the hummingbird, moth, caterpillar, and nicotine. There are several of them. They try to, you know, they have, it's a huge, Plankton Institute has done a lot of work in Arizona, and it is really fascinating. So they do have, this particular caterpillar does not have addiction for tobacco, which has also been found. Next slide. I think this is the last slide. Next slide. Yeah. Sometimes we feel, we can see a few things. Sometimes we can't see. On the left-hand side, what you see is an actually insect. It is called leaf insect. All of us know, might have seen a lot of pictures on, you know, internet where there is actually mimicry. Mimicry in the sense, the you would have seen stick insects. You would have seen insects like stones. You would have seen insects like bark. You can't differentiate them from the surroundings. So we get fascinated about it. And on the left-hand side, what you see is actually a leaf insect. It looks exactly like leaf. And when if it is there, its predator cannot see it. Its predator will think that it is one of the leaves, dry leaves, which is present in the, you know, heap. But the same behavior is there among plants also, but we cannot appreciate it unless we really understand. Now, what you see on the right-hand side are three grasses. Now, the first grass is actually paddy rice. Paddy is actually a grass. So paddy rice. The second one is a weed, which is seen on, this is called barn grass, which is actually a weed only in the paddy rice. But you can see the deception. The first and second look very much similar. It is just like the leaf insect looking like leaf. This one looks exactly like this, and you cannot differentiate it till it blooms, till it gives you. Then by the time it gives you seeds, it is too late. So such mimicry is there in the plant world. They also mimic. The third one is not a weed of this particular grass. It is a weed of rye grass. That's why it looks like rye. So this kind of deception is there. And many a times we don't realize that you might have seen that all the trees have got leaves beyond the 5 feet or 6 feet. This is basically the plant is trying to escape from herbivore or an animal like antelope or cow. So it will not let its leaves to be eaten by them. That's actually escape mechanism. Lastly, very interestingly, if there is a deer which comes to a landscape where there are a lot of, there's a lot of grass, who should be scared? If a tiger comes, the grass does not get scared because the tiger does not eat grass. But when the deer comes, it really gets scared because the deer will eat. So once a deer eats a little part of, grass, the grass will emit one, volatile oil, and other grasses start becoming either bitter or start becoming, start getting an anti-digestant. That is, if the antelope eats that grass, it doesn't get digested. Gas, people talk about gas, it will have really, literally, it will have a nitrogenous gas, and it doesn't like that grass. Secondly, another way of escape is these grasses grow in plenty. When you have so many of them, some of them have to escape. This is actually one of the strategies that the plants adopt to escape from herbivores. Last slide, please. Okay. Now, do plants have self-protection? I always ask people, do you have hesitation in taking a coconut water and just drinking it? But does the coconut tree get clean water? No, coconut tree does not get clean water, but then coconut tree has got an ability to filter out mechanically as well as chemically and add nutrition to that and give it to you. So that's something is a wonder of the world because it has got something called peptides. Peptides are small proteins inside the coconut water, which cannot let the bacteria or fungus or virus to grow inside. Similarly, green gram has the same ability. Green gram has got proteins which cannot let anybody else. Another good example is lotus. I always make fun. So I was going with my friend to jog, and on the way we stopped and there was a lily, actually not really lotus, flower in the water. I asked my friend pathologist, can you drink that water? He said, no, how can I drink? I will get infection. I said, then how does that lotus survive? Is it because Modi government is in the center? BJP government is in the center? He just laughed and, you know, nothing political about it. I'm just joking. So that means that particular lotus has the ability to combat the microorganism around that within the water. So that means that must have something to fight the fungus or bacteria. So we have developed some antibacterials from lotus stem and lotus leaves. Similarly, aloe vera. Aloe vera too has the similar activity. The third one is again interesting. You would have seen cucumber. You will have no hesitation of picking up a cucumber from a garden and just washing it and just eating. Now, the question to you is, if I go and keep a sandwich there and I ask you to take it, wash it and eat, will you eat? You wouldn't eat. So why are you so confident about cucumber? And how does cucumber protect itself from this microbiome around that? Cucumber also has, if you look at, there is a sap, and cucumber is very peculiar. If you look at the cucumber is only the one of the rare fruits which escapes completely from the its stalk. No, stalk goes completely. So that is because to see. So it has got that sap. That sap has got proteins which actually kill the microbes which are around that. As that becomes more and more, I mean, as you dry that, the sap becomes less, and you can see that it starts getting infected. Lastly, carrots, for example. Isn't it a wonder that carrot is right inside there in the farm where there are microbes everywhere and nothing happens to the carrot? It is sweet. It is juicy. It has got sugars in it. Nothing happens to that. So lastly, oranges. This is the most interesting part. Oranges are the most vulnerable because they are the most juicy fruits ever you can see. And they are least protected. All other, if you look at watermelon, if you look at cucumber, all of them have got a leathery outside protection, whereas oranges and lemons don't have such a protection. They have very soft rind, which can be removed very easily. So how does that then protect itself? It has got something called biomolecular complexes in that, which protect it completely from, if a bird goes and eats it, bird will start vomiting. If an insect goes and tries to eat, insect will die. So these biomolecular complexes have been, we have extracted all these and we have created some of, face wash and something for human use. Next slide, please. Okay, so that's about the plant science in brief. Hope you enjoyed it. It is about how do you look at the survival strategies of plants and how we can make use of it for human use, either for medicine or maybe in the industry or elsewhere. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, I'll be